Well, hello, everybody. Welcome. My name's Philip Brown. Hey, today we're going to talk about the sine rule. Yes, we've got two questions for us today. First of all, what is the sine rule? Second, where does it come from, right? So let's go ahead and dive into it. So triangles, that's what trig is all about. So let's say we have a right triangle, angle A, triangle ABC right here. So one thing we've got to recognize here is that the letters can get a little confusing. Capital A, we're going to say, is the angle. So ABC, those capital letters, those are the angles, and the opposite will be the lowercase. So side A will be opposite of angle A, side B will be opposite of angle B, and C is the hypotenuse. It's opposite of the right angle, right? So of course the Pythagorean theorem works, and sine is defined as opposite over hypotenuse, right? So therefore the sine of angle A would be side A divided by the hypotenuse, which is side C. So sine works perfect without any hitch. No, nothing special needed for all right triangles, right? But what if we have a triangle that's not a right triangle? Well, no longer do we have a hypotenuse. And the hypotenuse, in case you're not sure, it's not just the longest side. It's the longest side of a right triangle. It's opposite of the right angle. We no longer have a right angle. No hypotenuse, right? So then how can we use sine for something like this? So where does that sine rule come from? Well, here, I'll show you. So check this out. If we have any triangle, we could draw a line that's perpendicular to one of the sides that intersects one of the angles like we've done right here. So let's go ahead and call this point of intersection M and this side, side M, all right? So I know that's a, because this C right here is related to that. This A is related to this A. This B, well, we cut it in half, right? So now, check this out. So we have this little right triangle in here. Let's go ahead and talk about the sine of angle A for this new triangle. Would you agree then that it would be M over C, right? You see how that works? So we've got this triangle right here. Angle A did not change. Side A didn't change, but now we have this little triangle inside of it. So we have angle A, side M. So the sine of A would be M over C, right? Now let's do the same thing with angle C right here. So angle C is over here. It's in this other triangle on the right-hand side. The sine of angle C would be M over A, because the hypotenuse of this one is A. All right, now we're going to use the transitive property, which, man, it's the most powerful thing in math, right? So the way it works is if A equals B and B equals C, then it has to be the case that A also equals C. That can be a little confusing, but it's like if John has as much money as Sally and Sally has as much money as Bob, then John has as much money as Bob, right? So we're going to go ahead and rearrange this over here so we can come up with some sort of identity. A equals B and A equals something else. So then those are equal. So check this out. What we're going to do is we're going to multiply both sides by A and reduce that. We're going to multiply this one, both sides by C, reduce, and here's what we've got, right? So since M equals M, right, and M equals C sine of A, and M also equals A sine of C, right? So that means that C sine of A must equal A sine of C, right? They're both equal to M, so they have to be equal to each other. All right, so let's go ahead and simplify this a little bit, see what we can do. If we divide both sides by C and A, do a little bit of reducing right here, right? So the C's reduce, the A's reduce. Look what we get. Man, we get sine A over A equals sine C over C. That's pretty cool. Now, what about B, you might be wondering? Well, take our same exact triangle. Remember how we had this, cut it apart this way? So what if we put another line? So let's say we go here. We're going to have the same exact thing right here, right? So let's go ahead and get into it. So if we did the sine of A would be M over B. B is the hypotenuse for this triangle right here. And if we did the sine of angle B, right, because we're trying to figure out what B is, that would be M divided by the hypotenuse of this triangle over here would be A. Go ahead and rearrange them a little bit. Right, multiply both sides by A, multiply both sides by B. On the other one, now we have two expressions for M. M equals B sine of A, and M equals A sine of B. Therefore, these two things, they must be equal. Let's set them equal. Let's simplify them, right? Divide both sides by A times B, reduce, and there we go. So we have sine A divided by A equals sine B divided by B. We found out earlier that sine A divided by A also equals sine C divided by C. So therefore, boom, transitive property one more time. There's our rule right there. Last thing, you might be wondering, well, sometimes you see where the sides are in the numerator and the sines are in the denominator. So let's see how where that comes from right here. So let's just go ahead and start dealing with just two of them, right? It doesn't matter which two we start with, same way it would work out. So let's multiply. Essentially what we're going to end up doing is we're going to end up doing what is often called as cross multiplication. So let's multiply by the reciprocal over here. And let's go ahead and reduce to see those things we're going to reduce just to 1. And then let's go ahead and multiply both sides by A divided by sine of A. So the reciprocal of this and everything's going to reduce, right? Looks way uglier than it is. And we end up with B over sine B equals A over sine A. And that is, of course, going to be equal to C over the sine of C. So that's where the sine rule comes from. I think that's a pretty cool little exploration. I hope it was understandable to you. If you have just the slightest understanding of trigonometry, a little bit of algebra. So hey, do all the stuff the cool kids are doing. Like, subscribe, share, comment, let me know how it went. Hey, check out my Substack. I've got a weekly fun math problem. Give some resources to any teacher that'd like to use those questions in their classroom. Check out my website on teachingmath.org. And of course, there's a bunch of good stuff on Teachers Pay Teachers. So hey, I hope you found this enjoyable, and I would like to talk to you very soon. So I hope you see you in the next one.